So first, a quick introduction. My name is Mario Brandenburg. I'm a member of the German Parliament since the last federal election. I'm in the Committee for Education and Research. I'm in the so-called Enquete Commission for Artificial Intelligence, and I'm a member of the Digital Agenda. So basically, each and every commission which has something to do with the fields of technology. Starting with the presentation, so basically, when I arrived here, I felt like kind of being or living in three worlds. So before, in my previous life, I was a computer scientist. I worked for the European software company SAP. So I'm a computer scientist by nature and more or less was a techie all my life. I'm not a metropolitan guy, not living in Berlin or Hamburg, so I like it more relaxed. I live on the countryside and it always felt a bit displaced. So nobody back home understood the tech stuff I wanted to do and the other way around. So I started with local politics and I'm basically still doing that in my other life. And it felt like there are two worlds between tech and, let's say, the ordinary people. Now I moved into federal politics and I realized there's even another world which basically doesn't understand the other world. So it's more or less a triangular. So the Silicon Valley tech guys basically don't understand politics, while politics don't understand them, while the ordinary people tell, yeah, this is politics. And I felt that I'm more or less the translator and the messenger of these worlds. And I want to share my findings with you and basically let you know why I think AI can make the difference in that area and why we have a momentum at the moment. So to visualize you what's the problem often in political decisions, so to make it very visual. So on the one hand side, that's probably you and me, the digital natives, or at least the digital immigrants, depending how old you are. And this is how we see life. So there is streaming, Netflix, platform economy, and all these things. And on the other hand side, I call them the others. They are more or less living their normal, let's say, analog life. And what I learned when it comes to political decisions, they are often done with the others in mind. So basically, they are done that they work for everybody. And we're realizing, or at least I'm realizing, that there is a gap. So we have a little digital divide here. Then the decisions are taken for the others are not matching the decisions taken for the digital natives. And this is a problem for society because we are all interested that things work together. And the differentiator on that is basically that with AI, we've got new possibilities to make these worlds come back together. And to basically be more successful in AI, I define some fields where I think politics should be more visionary and have more ambitions. So to basically share them with you. Obviously, you're in Spain, I'm in Germany. Unfortunately, we couldn't show you the nice view because it's just too bright and I look too dark then, so you have to see this nice German white wall. So I'm in Germany, you're in Spain, and we're speaking English. And that's one of the basic things in a global world and in a war for talent. So if you are a badass data scientist coming from Stanford, you studied, you spend lots of money, why would you move to Germany if you have to learn another language? So you really want to start, you want to do code, you want to work, why would you start to learn another language? So I think we in Europe, it should be possible, or at least in Germany you have to start, but I hope in Europe we come to that point that basically the second administrative language in all countries is English. So you shouldn't have any problems with filling in your tax forms and stuff and send your kids to school or whatever. So if we really want to race the global race, we should be honest and say, okay, let's face it, English should be the second administrative language. The next point I wanted to make, and in the presentation you see state invest. So that's the thing, that there is not enough capital in the market compared to the US and to China. Germany is too small, Spain is too small, so we are Europe, but each and every country has the task to bring capital into the market. And at least in Germany, it's that way that we can invest in concrete, like housing, or in state bonds. For example, if we think about the pension plans and the money the state has to save. So, and that's not the future, concrete or state bonds. Why is it not possible to invest into the future, into the heads and ideas of our kids? So there are some European countries doing a better job, and this is what I'm pushing for, that at least some of the money, which basically the German state has to save for pension funds, whatever, has to flow back in the venture capital system, and we should invest in the ideas and in the heads of our kids and children, and not only in concretes and buildings. So the next thing is a true story that my mom basically came up and said, yeah, I've read a lot about this AI stuff. Like, how can I invest? I've got 5K. So, and the thing is, there's probably no chance. I mean, I cannot tell her whatever. Run your own venture company, build a tokenized fund or something. So that's a problem. How can ordinary people, not really tech ambitious, but really believing in this is good and wanting giving other people a chance, invest? So I think a state should come up with a smart idea to do some kind of micro investing or whatever, which basically the state says, okay, this is safe. So I don't want the state to be an actor in the market. I'm a liberal. That's absolutely not what I want to push for. But the state has basically to go forward and empower these models and say, look, this is okay. You can do this or that. And the last part, I phrased it a right to use technology. So this is not meant to be like a real right written down in a law, but I want to give you an example. Personally, I'm following what the company 23andMe is doing. So I think it's super interesting. You can send them a little test. They encode your genome, and then they send you back an ancestry report and basically a health report. So who are my relatives, like to how much percentage I'm from the African continent, this and that. And this is the part you get, even as a German or a European in that case. But you don't get the health report. So because we are not living in the US and that's not allowed, I don't get the facts on health. And these are the real interesting ones for me. So why can I send them my genome, my information, and not get the result? So this stresses me as user. But if we think about it in a broader context, how could you run a company like that over here in Germany if you're not even allowed to hand out the results? So it basically will never happen. And the whole things about genome editing, CRISPR, this will be the next big thing. And if we basically overprotect people who are willingly to go down that way, who say, okay, look, I know about data protection, I'm sure about it, I want to do it. If we overprotect them, we become unattractive as a market as well. And the last point I wanted to stress on that is we need to be more bold and visionary on political side. In the end, probably all of us, even companies, but especially politicians, need to draw a positive utopia where we want to go with that. Because if we don't come up with our own utopia, we might, on the other hand, get the Silicon Valley or the Chinese utopia, and we don't want that. Or we might even get a dystopia. And this is why I put it as an example, the brain upload. I found that discussion very interesting, and we are far from possible. But there is this idea that one day we might have a brain cloud where we can upload our brains and whatever. And I heard that, and I had this blogging idea of, well, what's that? But think about it. How cool would it be to sit down on a Saturday and download Barack Obama's brain and relive his life? Instead of going at the museum and staring at the cup or mug he might have used on whatever Thursday. So these are the stories which are interesting and which we have to tell people to show, look, this can make sense in a broader scope, and to show them that their politicians are caring and they are willing to think a bit far than tomorrow. And this is basically what I think politicians should do. And why do I think AI is different here? And why AI can be the game changer. And I want to as well explain that in a personal example. When I studied computer science for quite a while, because I traveled the world, my mom never ever asked me anything about an exam or whatever Java class. So she was just not interested. The moment I joined the committee for artificial intelligence, every time I pick up my kids, I have to tell her, what's going in AI and what's the new things, what's coming up? She's super interested. So people are interested in that topic. We see this. Society is talking, ordinary people are talking, politicians like myself and even the other ones are now talking, and industry is talking about it. So that's the momentum where basically all of us are interested in one thing. And this was never really the same when we take digitalization as, let's say, the first wave of it. That was the stuff for the tech people. So ordinary people really didn't care, and politicians for a long time did ignore it. It's absolutely different with AI, and this is why I think we have a game changer here, if basically we all do it right together. And this is basically as well my last slide, since I don't want to make it in 10 minutes. So the difference here is that we are all in it together. And I often tell that to people, look, in Germany not even 1% of the population is active in politics. So, and if you ever worked in HR and think about talent pools, so this means that all the decisions are taken by 1%. And if you think that a bit farther, 99% are more or less not involved. And that's the real big talent pool. And so this is basically my shout out to you as industry, but as human beings, as part of society, and to politicians, or basically to you, to support your politicians. Call them up, talk with them, even with the local ones, because even if you don't have the time because you run a company to actively participate in that system, that's okay, but give input. So give all the information into the system. There will be other ones transferring them. But as long as we're not constantly talking and repeating the tech questions, other topics will cover it. I just say refugee crisis and whatever. So, and these are no topics for the future. They are to some extent, but these are topics of the past as well. And we really need to sort out how we want to live with AI, how we want to earn the money of the future, and basically what this all means for society. And therefore, I highly encourage you to ring up your politicians, send them emails, or even join a political party just once to explain them your standpoint and your view, because finally, we are in it together. So, thanks for listening, and obviously something went wrong. Sorry for not giving this speech live. Hopefully, we can have a Q&A afterwards. Let's see what happens. So, my name is Mario Brandenburg. You can basically hit me up on all social media channels, send me an email, LinkedIn, whatever. I'm happy for every input. I hope you had a nice meeting, and maybe we can make it next time and to meet personally in Spain or wherever. Thank you very much.